It is Tuesday, and you know what that is. It means this is a new episode of No Filter. Today, I say this every week, I know, but I am extremely, extremely looking forward to today's show and episode. Because this man is a family to me, but not only family, he is and stands for the word fashion. This is an industry I've worked in for more than 34 years. And I've known this man every step of the way. This man is a true icon, true legend, and he has created iconic looks for pop stars, Hollywood, blockbusters, operas, ballet, all around the world. Last year, he celebrated half a century in this business. And I cannot wait to speak to him about it. When you look at him, you'll never believe that because he just doesn't look like his age. But ladies and gentlemen, I am so, so honored today to introduce and bring to you Jean-Paul Gaultier.
Hello, Naomi.
Oh my goodness.
Hello. So pleased to see you.
This is a relationship right here.
Yeah.
Almost 35 years, Jean-Paul.
Yes, because I remember the first time you made my show. It was your first show in Paris, because you remember how it happened. I saw you in the English L. You were just like, I don't know, 16, something like that.
1986.
You know? Exactly. And I saw that girl, when she will come to Paris, I want to see her. And you came and you are fabulous, of course, because you can see it and always fabulous. Anyway, so.
I don't even know where to start, because first of all, bonjour, Jean-Paul.
Yeah.
And can you tell us, where are you? Where are you in the world?
Alors, here, at the moment, I am in Paris. And for the last year, I am between, like, south of France, like, close to Biarritz, which is, like, south, close to Spain, you know, very nice, beautiful, huh? Greece also, because my boyfriend is Greek also.
Wow.
And Paris also for projects, things like that that I am doing.
But Jean-Paul, I have to say something to you. You look fantastic.
Are you
really
sure?
Really fantastic. You enjoy your life.
Yes, that is the best thing, truly, honestly. Even when I stopped my last show, you know, I was happy because I think I did everything I was dreaming, even more than I could have expected when I was young, you know. So now I have new projects, which are always around fashion, but not exactly fashion, which are more about show business and like shows, you know. Like my fashion.
Jean-Paul, I remember even though you did fashion shows, prêt-à-porter, couture, you always had special projects for the ballet, for the opera, for Madonna. We're going to get into that. So the first time we met was, I guess, the fall 86.
Yeah. Exactement. So that's incredible. And you were like absolutely incredible because so professional and at the same time innocent but professional.
Innocent? Me?
You were yourself already. Your personality was there, you know. It's incredible. You were a revelation.
Remember? Yeah. Your show was one of the shows that made me very nervous inside, and that was a good thing. And it was in this beautiful, like La Villette, no? La Villette.
Exactly.
And Diane Brill, and the extraordinary catwalks that were up like roller coasters. I mean, you have really done it.
Yeah.
You have done it, and you've done it around the world and back. When all these other celebrities, you would mix with us and with the models, and what your history and body of work is, to see what people came later on to understand is really amazing. It's amazing. Your history, your journey is incredible.
It was a beautiful adventure each time.
Jean-Paul, where do you get your inspiration from? How does it arrive? Because you really have done You've covered the spectrum.
I will tell you truly one thing that truly like give me a lot of inspiration was London, because I find in London, you know, a lot of creativity on people that are more like personage and incredible, not like in Paris where it's sometimes boring chic, you know. So it was more like people expressing themselves. So there are more freedom, and that give me always like I was like saying, oh yes, I can do what I want to do, because you know they do it in London what they want to do. So me, I have to do the same thing. It gave me that, because in Paris it was, oh no, it's not very chic, it's not very
elegant. Well, where were you? You were born where?
I was born in the suburb of Paris, you know, south suburb, in a very humble family, but very nice people. And I was very lucky because I have parents that were very open-minded, you know. They were very nice, very simple. My grandmother was like quite incredible, because she was like a faith healer, you know, and she was playing, she was a nurse, faith healer, on playing cards, on saying 1, 2, 3, 4, you will have big success, she told me. So even if I was like a boy that was a little, let's say, fragile, and with a sensibility, which were more like beginning of being gay, etc., she felt
that's
it.
Wonderful, you had a grandmother like that.
Yeah, she told me, she make me understand, don't worry, anyway, even if you are like that, everything will be all right.
I heard you asked your parents for a poupée, a doll.
Ah, yeah. No, my parents didn't want, because they said for a boy is not good. So I took my teddy bear and I put him with 2 cone bra before Madonna.
I've seen this teddy bear, and it's incredible that you did that. How old were you?
I was like, 5 years old.
That's unbelievable.
5 years
That's
old.
Unbelievable.
And he was with a conic bra. And after I make him, like I saw at the TV, Folie Bergère, and the girl with the feather. So I put the thing like to clean, you know, with feathers to the head of my teddy bear. And he became like a Folie Bergère girl. And everything like that. And I was making the show for my grandmother. It was my first impact, you know, like, because Folie Bergère, it was more like about a show, you know. And after I saw at 13 years old, like Falbala, which was a movie about like haute couture and fashion, but a love story. And I said, ah, it's not show only like Folie Bergère, it's that now that I
it's
want to
do. That now.
But I love to make fashion, you know why? Because fashion, it was shown through a movie. So it was a show. So it was with the light, with the muse, with the girl, and I learned everything. I didn't go to school of fashion, that was my school.
So you never went to school of fashion?
Never. My first school, when I started at the day of my 18 years old, I came back from the college, and you know what? And my mother told me, Pierre Cardin phoned because he received your sketches, because I sent sketches to different couturiers, and come to see him. So I said, okay, I go, but if you go with me, because I am too shy.
So your mom went?
What?
She went with you?
Yes, yeah, she went with me.
I love this.
I went. And he took me, and I start to work with, and what was incredible with Pierre Cardin, that you know very well, because I know you were even in the documentary.
I did his documentary, May He Rest in Peace. We just lost the great Pierre Cardin.
Hey, yes.
I'm sorry.
He was one guy, but you were there in the documentary, which is fab, and where it was showing that he also chose different girls of different color, even
correct.
Japanese girls, like black girls, Indian girl also.
Yes.
His studio with assistant was with that. We were 13 nationalities different. From all over the world.
All over the world.
It was quite an over to everything. And he was doing already himself was
so very... How long did you stay at Pierre Cardin?
Very few times, 6 months.
Short time.
So little time, but I learned everything there, and I was free. and I saw freedom. And so it gave me the freedom after to make what I wanted to do, you know. So when
then did you go on to your own after that? That was it?
I met my boyfriend. No, I went to Cardin again. I went to Jean Patou, which was an old beautiful house, you know. And after that, I met my boyfriend, and we have no money, and he told me he has my age, you know, and he told me, oh yes, you can do that together. And with no money, we try to do something. And we did with nothing. And that's very good. To do it with nothing.
The best way.
is the best way. Because like that, you know, you are not like a pourri, how do you say, like,
you're not chained to anybody.
Yeah, and what that you do, you find solution, and you have to find solutions. That's the best
survival.
If you have everything you desire since the beginning, after you are no more creative. After you are always can find a solution.
And this explains your all of your sensibility of how, since I've known you, how you work, because you've always felt with you a freedom.
Exactement.
You live it, breathe it, you are that.
But I am lucky, I should say. Freedom is the best, the most important thing in life, you know.
What do you tell to these young fashion designers today when they ask you advice, Jean-Paul? Because you really, you have such a rich, encrusted...
Is that each one has to first assume themselves and their envy and what they want to do. They can listen to people. There is some people that can give good advice. But if you believe in something, do what in what you believe. That is the only thing, you know. In what you believe, you will do it with all your energy, all your love, and that is the best thing to do. So even if you listen, but do what you want.
But you, what I mean, you really have championed. No one can ever say to you that you never championed gender, diversity. You have done it all way before anyone ever thought about it. And that was one of the things I really looked forward to. I mean, it was a big deal to get to walk in your show, Jean-Paul. Any of the girls that were not booked to the agency, they always like, are you doing Gaultier? I'd be like, yes. Because if you were not doing Gaultier, you were not hip. you were not in that circle of the avant-garde. I'm sorry, that was it. That really was. It wasn't never about money with you. It was about creativity. And if you were not in your show, it was not a good look for you. But can we talk about Madonna?
Of course.
Your relationship with Madonna has been incredible.
Well,
and I should say one thing before we get to Madonna. You said you love England.
Wait.
And you told me that before numerous times. But what can you tell us what you got into television in England? I remember that.
Yes, Eurotrash. I did with Antoine de Caunes. I did that program, which was incredible. Honestly, England, yes, have been always something very special, you know, for me. Always. You know, in my first shows that I did, was I was almost no critics or no journalists, you know. The only ones that were English people. On Japanese.
And our beloved Ray Petrie, who I know you.
Yeah, of course. So talentous. There is so brilliant, talentous people in London. The energy and the sense of tongue in cheek and to make funny things, sense of humor, which we have not.
I agree. I just wish that my home country would support the arts a bit more. Because we really do have some great, we've always had great talent, but we don't have the support for the talent.
It's true. Because there is a lot of incredible talent and incredible beauty also in London, I should say.
Now, Madonna.
Yes.
When did you guys first meet? Because it became a very public love affair.
Yeah, but honestly, no. First time I meet her, it was without meeting her. It was in the MTV. First time I make a show in New York. First and last time I make a show in New York. It was in 85. It was a moment and after. So it was with Bergdorf and Goodman. So I did that show. And after, there was the MTV, first MTV award. When she did, you know, like a virgin, yeah, with a microphone between the legs.
Mm-hmm.
Now, nobody could do it now at that moment, you know, in life, in a thing like that, you know, and she was incredible. So, and all the girls that were dressed like her, you know, were like clapping, and the one of showbiz were more like, you know, but after, like, she sold 2 million album, you know, after they find her fabulous, you know, but she was fab, of course, and I love her. But I saw her first without singing in live, you know. It was at Top of the Pop in London, where she was singing only
Holiday. The Pops, yeah.
What a black girl. It's an English one. I couldn't imagine, I'm sorry, but that she was American, because for me, she was on the... Only how she was dressed already was fab, you know. So I said, she is English. And after I learned, no. And I saw her. And after she wore some of my thing, even for the premiere of Suzanne, Seeking Suzanne Desperately.
Desperately Seeking Suzanne.
Yeah. which was a fabulous, where
yeah,
she was
love fantastic. That film.
Oh yeah, she was like with some of my things, you know, and she bought some of my things. And one time I met her only in really, and speaking to her after one show she did in Paris. You know what? The show was finished. It was in Sceaux. It was in 87 or 88. Well, I was missing 87. And after the show was finished, 1 hour after, there were like a soirée in the palace. So she went there, but she was la première to be there. Me, I ran second. She was already there. She finished the show. She takes the car. And I saw her and I say, oh, Madonna, I love you. I said, oh, truly that, you know. And I was say, you know, because I saw she has like a little thing, like a little corset at that time that was like a little copy of mine, you know. Yeah, and I said, don't take a copy. I will do for you because I truly, I love so much. You know, I want to do it. After 6 months after, she called me like Jean-Paul. One of my assistants tell me, oh, it's Madonna at the phone. I said, oh, no. Allez, okay. It was before one of my show. I said, I will speak later. I couldn't imagine it was true. I saw it was a joke. So when she asked me to do the Blonde Ambition 2 for her, I was like crazy. And I said, wow, fabulous.
When you see the white shirt with the blue stripes, that's for me, that's you. That is such a signature of Jean-Paul Gaultier. I love you as a person. And that's how I, one of the visions, I always remember you with the white shirt with the stripes, with the blue stripe. The regular, typical, what would you call that?
Marinière of the French Navy.
Marinière.
But you know what I learned? I will tell you something about the Marinière. In reality, it's comment dit-on, a discover, creation, of the Navy of English Navy. Because you know why? Because one time there was a lot of sailors that fell into the water at night.
Yeah.
And one time I have stripes. So they could see him after with the light. They could see him in the night, in the water.
Yeah.
So after that they put all stripes, not the same stripe as mine, but stripe was
that
from
makes
the
sense.
Clever British.
Because I mean, I've gone to wear those stripes down your runway a few times over the decades.
Yeah.
Different variations.
Exactly. I love that.
Now, Celine Dion, I heard that she went or wanted you also to make her some costumes, mm-hmm. as she'd seen you done for Madonna, and you were told her to go to the store. Is that true?
It's not exactly like that. I was not with that. It's only that I couldn't because I was doing, it was a third time I was doing something special for Madonna. So I couldn't do the show. She went to the shop and she bought something. And after I went to Las Vegas to see her. And after I said, sorry. And you know what she said? But she's a nice girl. You know what she said? I said, sorry, I couldn't do it to live with Madonna. I understand. I am not as good looking as Madonna. But like I like the clothes, I make my shopping. Cute.
That's so sweet. And then it was a pinnacle point, your creations in The Fifth Element, the Luc Besson, the Mia.
I love that. Yeah,
I remember that.
It was like a truly, like a very good souvenir. But most of the clothes, some were in Paris, but other were done also in London. You know, it was in the studio of James Bond.
Oh, so wait, is that Pinewood Studios, I think?
Pinewood Studios. No? Yeah. And I did also with Peter Greenaway. I did one movie.
You know
with
what? I did a movie in that studio. Do you wonder what movie it was?
No.
I'm in The Wall, Pink Floyd, The Wall.
Oh, yeah.
I did this movie with Alan Parker.
Mm-hmm. Fabulous, with Alan Parker. That's great.
Yeah. So Pinewood, they're excellent. They're so very good at what they do. So you had them make some of the costumes there and some in Paris?
Yeah, costume, some me in Paris, and some I went going there. And it was like incredible when they did all the decoration. The set was Pinewood Studio.
Do you have some of that collection of The Fifth Element within your exhibition? Do you have an exhibition at
Pinewood? Yeah.
Tours, right?
Yeah, it was there. And I have like the one of Bruce Willis. And also one of Mila, that I like.
Amazing. So now you had your 50th celebration last year, which was, I mean, I remember opening up Instagram, it was just everyone, the love. Jean-Paul, first of all, You could still continue if you wanted to. But I take my hat off to you that you just say, okay, I'm taking a step back. You don't do prêt-à-porter anymore, is that correct?
I don't do prêt-à-porter anymore. And now the couture will be done because of the problem of the COVID, it didn't start, but it will be done by each season, one new designer.
That's incredible. How are you going to choose those designers?
I choose already some. I choose Sakai.
Yes, you know,
she does a Sakai, which is very nice.
Her.
And she was supposed to do in last July. She was supposed to do also there, but we want to make a real show. So we cancel the two because we want a real show. So it will be normally in July. In July.
Inshallah.
And after it will be each time like a different designer.
Now, can I ask you, will it be designers that we know?
Are not very well, and some that you don't know.
This is fantastic. What a great platform.
But that come, I had the idea long time ago. It was in 87, something like that, when Christian Lacroix left Jean Patou to make his own collection with Arnaud, you know, Christian Lacroix Couture. So at that time, like me, I work at Jean Patou before. I was thinking, but Jean Patou now, they have no designer and they have not a real style. So maybe what should be good, it should be good if they were taking each year one designer, for example, Vivienne Westwood, for example, Thierry Mugler, for example, Claude Montana, and me, of course, and we could make each one
make
a collection. Like that, it should be like different style, but and because every one of us, Montana, Mugler, and Vivienne, were dreaming also about couture.
Of course. Is there going to be a criteria for how you choose these designers for your next? I mean, will people that we don't know be able to send you things for you to review their work to see if they stand a chance, because this is an incredible opportunity.
I think it's quite nice, and I think it's
nice. It's more than nice. It's a gift.
It's a challenge. When you love that profession, you are interested to do that, because what I do in couture, maybe it can be different. It's only to interpret a little code, but what they want, you know, it will not be do du Gaultier. No, it will be do. If you have an idea of yourself, of Gaultier, that you want to make and change and transform and destroy in some way, you can do it if you want, which is quite funny, you know.
I'm very much looking forward to this. This is what you're still giving back and helping others.
In reality, you know, it's the model of Mr. Cardin, because me, he shows me only by my sketches, you know, that he received. You know, and I have made no school, and it take me, you know, only because of my sketch, that it. So I think I have to make this the same thing for others, you know.
So everybody watching this, if you are incredible and artistic and creative and an amazing sketcher, look at this opportunity. Look what happened to Jean-Paul. Look, living dream.
Yeah. But I will not stop. I will do also the thing, you know, something also around like, you know, I did my Fashion Freak show, which is like...
I remember that.
Yeah, and that will come also in London and in America later. It was supposed to be days, but it will be later.
That's going to be more like in a theater environment, right?
Exactly.
Right.
More about that. You know, I like comedy musical, musicals, things like that. You know, you make it in my way. And I am preparing even another one, you know, like that. And also working with director artistic for a movie. Preparing
you are an artistic director too, yourself.
But I love that. You know, and I mean, to image and like that always. And it's my life. And that's my love also.
Talk to me about Sidaction. When did you start this charity? When did it begin?
The Sidaction was truly something like from France that we did long time ago, you know, Mr. Pierre Berger from Saint Laurent, you know, which was Yves Saint Laurent, did it the first with Lynn Renault, which is which is how Elizabeth Taylor and all the actresses, etc. Madonna even came and gave money for the Sid Action in beginning of 87 when she came first time. So it was very. So we make something to give money for research for AIDS, against AIDS, you know, because it is still. So we are doing a dinner sometime. It was in January, but we didn't do that time. We did something else, like a video. And we are doing also different moment, a TV program also, like to make, and I am now ambassador, and all that, like to give money for that.
Because it's still there. Raising awareness.
Yeah, because AIDS is still there, you know, it's not finished. Okay, we have the COVID.
Well, we've lost a lot of friends. We've lost a lot of people that we love.
Exactly.
HIV.
Exactly. So still go on to protect yourself, you know, to protect everybody.
I mean, I'm praying that this next generation, I mean, I'm praying, John Paul, that they're really going to find a cure.
Exactly, on vaccination, but now they don't find, because it's not so easy to make a vaccination for AIDS. But they have now some comprimé, you know, yes, that you can take, but it's not yet, it's not perfect. And some young
people. I've got a lot of friends that have lived 15 years by taking medicine.
Exactly, even I know some from 30 years now, that, but it's still something that can happen to you, you know, so you have to be careful.
You have to still, listen, everyone. You still
to be
have
safe,
to
safe sex.
Safe in sex.
Exactly.
You know what I mean?
Not forget, no one of them.
Us?
Safe on the sex is very important to go
safe on.
Safe
on the sex is very important. So don't think, get all, yes, we got COVID and we got sex too.
Definitely.
Please take care. Protect yourselves.
There is a solution. Something. You know what it is? It is like the integral rubber. Rubber body, all in rubber, like that, no problem. But it's not the same thing that the skin, I should say, you know.
You know which outfit I love that I wore? I got, and I saw, it was on your Instagram yesterday, of Kristen Bergstrom when she came out with looking like she had nothing on. The new dress with the boobs and the, you know,
even
the hair
that, even that embroidery.
And then I got to wear it when I shot with Paolo, which I was standing in the middle of Pigo. In this, everyone's looking at me like, look at this naked woman.
It's a beautiful photo. It was a beautiful photo of you.
I
just
love
fantastic.
That picture.
I love that one. In black and white, absolutely fabulous.
And then I had a little trench coat. Just a little trench coat on my shoulders.
Yeah, it was like not necessary.
Now we have another special human being that we just loved. And I remember when I would do your shows when I was 16 years old, Papa would be in the audience as Adine Elia.
Of course. Yes. Him, that was truly a great genius and truly a real couturier, knowing so much to make all the curves of the woman, you know, and doing it by himself, you know. He was truly excellent, talented, funny, irresistible, making a lot of jokes at the telephone.
He loved you, Jean-Paul.
So much. Oh, me
he
too.
He loved you so much, and he always respected you. There was very few shows he went to. Yours was one of them. He always respected you, always loved you for being you, for keeping to your integrity.
Big.
I miss him. You know, we miss him. Now, at Kenso Sakai will be July 7th,
exactly.
2021.
C'est
for ça. The first couture show, what do you think right now of the fashion in general? Like the inclusiveness of designers and the brands that are finally starting to open up the platforms like you've always done and letting the African continent, the Middle Eastern continent being able to come and share and be on the same platform.
I think that's good, that the fact that it's like global and like mondial, you know, I think that's quite good. The only thing I should say that for the moment I regret is like, because maybe I am from another generation, is the fact like the fashion show not to make for the moment no fashion show. I think for me it was the essence why I want to make fashion, you know, it was because it was a reality. So it's beautiful, the image, all visual, all by now they are doing in video. But honestly, I love when it's real and you have the emotion, like to go to the theater and you see, you don't know what can happen, you know? Mm-hmm. You, a lot of things that can happen and after it's finished, it's like something like a play of theater for like sometimes 30 minutes, sometimes for only 12 minutes, but you have that, the impact, the fact, the flash. It's fabulous. And I think you can speak also very well about it, you yourself.
Yeah, like I feel the same.
Like real and reality, and you feel the audience, you feel the people, the energy that it gives, and yourself, what you can give to them. And I one thing also that I regret is all the people that look behind the telephone, you know, because you, it's not like you receive it like showing on be with the emotion, because you are behind doing a good photo. No, it's not your job.
It's not the same.
It takes emotion. Yeah. That's for me, the live is the best thing. So what I am hoping is like it will come back, and all the things that we can see at theater, even in cinema, etc., will come back, and we will have like
that. But I'm sure they're going to find maybe a new way of doing it, but I absolutely agree with you in the sense of live.
Yes.
It's like you can't, something, can't invent that in film.
We need. It's like love, you know. Okay, virtual love. Okay, but it's virtual love. Can be interesting if you make it like a phantasmagoria and you're making like to create something different. But like if you are with reality, you have also some other different sensation. So yeah. Sensually and emotionally, that's important also to be there, even if it is not all.
Yeah.
It has to be there still. I think they will have those.
We don't. You are a true legend and icon and everything and every accolade that they can name in our world of fashion. I mean, are you traveling these days to like talk to these young designers in these emerging markets like Qatar, Africa, Nigeria? Would you do that?
But now it's too late because now I am on show business, you know, I am working on that kind of thing. So for me, no. And to be honest, I have not been so much interested about market or things like that. You know, it's not my job. Me, I'm doing my clothes, making things beautiful, being attracted by news like you that can inspire me. It's more that creative processes that interest me. So it's interesting. I can say, for example, maybe to help for some people or giving advice and things like that. That, yes. But like to make business from that anymore, no.
No, not business, just to give advice, mentorship.
Ah, that, yes. That's a pleasure.
Yeah.
They want to hear, okay, but they have to do their own choice themselves.
They have to do their homework.
Maybe that, but after, do yourself and choose yourself.
Jean-Paul, your African, that African collection, the Frida Kahlo collection. Do you remember, I asked you if I love the Frida Kahlo show. And I asked you, I was doing David Letterman. And I asked you, could I wear it on David Letterman? And you sent it to me in New York. You sent me my outfit that I had in the show. And you let me wear it on David Letterman. Never forget,
perfect.
I wore the thorns and everything.
Yeah. It was a great show. I love that one.
Oh,
and you are fantastic. Are you passing with Tanel on Alexander?
And you know what other show I loved? The show with Christy and Kate, the Indian show, when we had all the marching.
The tattoo collection. And after you get the piercing on the nombril.
That collection was, I mean, I still have that collection in my archive.
But you know what?
You had that stretch fabric, that thin stretch fabric that was also such a...
Yeah, like a tulle, like a stretch tulle.
Signature of yours with the little line on the back.
But you know how it came? It came that desire to do one complete collection like that. It's because I was in London and I saw that there was like a meeting of people that were with tattoo and piercing. People that truly were... So I went there and it was incredible how beautiful tattoos they were, you know. So that was in
1993?
Oui, voilà, exactly. Yeah. But so I did it 1 year before, the time to do it. So it was the beginning in 91 maybe. And I went there and I saw one in London, one woman that I saw, like a lady that should be around like 60 years old, but she has like a black skirt and she has see-through transparent organza blouse, you know, black, and under it, like, comment dit-on ça, bonnet, like, comment dit-on,
bustier, a bra,
c'était gorge. Yeah, and she had a bra that was with flowers, bon, and I went close to her, so I said, for 60 years old, not bad, no, and yeah. She, when I arrived, it was not a bra, it was tattoo, flower tattoo on her breast. Wow. London, yeah. 12 points. Fabulous.
No, that's, you know, it was just, for me, the feeling we knew when we were arriving to your show that we were going to be transformed into Gaultier world, and we were stepping into your world, and it was just like, just sit in the chair and let do whatever you want to do to me, because it was just so magical to be part of it.
Thank you. And thank you. So much. But you know, I will tell you something. Honestly, I think that I should not have done collection like that if there were not people like you, beautiful, inspiring, that give me the energy and the volunteer to do it. Because I think a clothes with nothing, like you can see, no, it's the other way, yeah, there. Oops. There, yeah. Voila, here, voila. If you, it's nothing when there is nothing like that. You know, if you, there is nobody inside, if there is somebody that know how to move, how herself, you know, naturally, with the color of the skin, of the hair, which the attitude which is inside, doesn't exist, no clothes. I should not have done clothes. It's because of the movie I saw walking somebody alive was with all the light. Is that, you know?
But so that's the most exactly important. It when you mixed us up at the fashion shows and with the real people, with singers from Nina Hagen to, I mean,
where,
Frank and Diane Brill. So it was just like, when you're backstage, you're like, well, how does this work? But then when the show started, you understood the story. And it was incredible, really incredible. You are truly a living legend. And what I cannot get over, what year was it that you went to Pierre Cardin? 1970?
Yes, 21st of April, 1970.
I wasn't born yet.
That's what?
Incredible, and look at you. I wasn't born yet. I was born in May, 1970. Look at you. Can you believe this, everyone? This is incredible.
I believe that I am that old, you know, because truly I can't see the difference.
You should never tell, you don't look your age, whatever your age is.
Because well, anyway, in my head, it is not exactly the same age.
Exactly.
I go on to stay like my first dream realized. On the
We're in another movie now. Jean-Paul Gaultier, I'm so grateful to you today for your time. You are a legend,
pleasure.
You are a family member to me. We have so many people we love, Farida, we love and share.
Exactly, sis.
And I can't wait to see what you do next. I can't wait, and I'm just like,
you will know.
Whatever we
definitely,
do, we're there.
Definitely, to my new project also.
Always and forever.
If you can be part of this project, I will see you on television.
You know, wherever you ask me, if I can be there, I'm there for you, because I believe definitely. And trust you. And that's what it is. It's a trust, you know?
Sincerely.
Recreate me. I love you so much. I'm so grateful to you for today. Thank you, thank you, thank you.
Thank you, thank you.
For your time.
Thank you, Naomi.
Jean-Paul Gaultier. Listen to his name. Jean-Paul Gaultier. Just sounds so chic, doesn't it? What a legend. What a legend, what a journey. If you don't know Jean-Paul's journey, please go online and take a look. He's done absolutely everything. And look at him, ready for the next phase, handing out his platform of his company to young and other designers. This is a man that is truly remarkable. And I hope that you've enjoyed hearing our stories and bantering. It's so exciting to talk to him, so I'm sorry if I spoke over each other, but it's just, this man has been such a pinnacle point in my life and in my career as a model, and I owe him so much. So please like today's video and don't forget to subscribe to my YouTube channel. Sending you my love and telling you please stay safe. Brown Girls out.